Now we get into a delicious part of our service, and that's opening the Word of God. If you'll take your Bibles and turn to 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 18 through 20. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 18 through 20. Peter is reminding us the people to whom he was writing. He said, knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver and gold, but you were ransomed with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without spot or blemish. He was forsaken before foreknown before the foundation of the world, but was made manifest in the last times for your sake. May the Lord add his blessings and anoint you, Pastor, as you speak to us now.
Thank you, Lord, for your love to us and your abundant goodness. Thank you for the gift of your Son. Father, forgive us of our sins. Wash us and cleanse us that we may receive of your Spirit, that we may have our eyes open and our ears open, Lord, and understand and see the things that your great love has revealed to us in your Word. Father, quicken our understanding that we may be able to understand the love of God, your love, in its height and its depth and its breadth and its width. And draw us closer to yourself this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to be starting a new series on Salvation's Blueprint. We're going to touch on a little bit on the sanctuary, but more than that, we're going to go into the deeper meaning and how each of these things were fulfilled. And I have a burden for this because, you know, as I was studying for this week, I recognize that we know a lot of information. We know the prophecies, we know the meaning of symbols, but in a lot of ways, we don't know the Savior and the fullness of his love for us that we really need to know. And so my prayer has been this week that God would help me understand that in a deeper and fuller way, and that he'd help me share that with you. I'm on a journey here, but we need to understand these things and their application to our life, to us. The Bible tells us that your way, O God, is in the sanctuary. There is a way that God has revealed by which man can come to God and find peace and acceptance and the path home. And that way is through Jesus. It's through the sanctuary. Notice what Thomas asked Jesus. Jesus was at the Last Supper. Jesus is telling his disciples, I'm about ready to depart. And the disciples are saying, wait a second. We don't want you to go anywhere. We're going to be lost without you. And he says, you know where I'm going and you know the way. And Thomas says, no, hold on. We do not know where you're going and we do not know the way. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going and how can we know the way? And notice Jesus' answer to him. Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to where? The Father, except through me. Where was Jesus going shortly after his death? Back to his Father. Where had Jesus come to share with the disciples the path, the way to return to the Father? He'd come here to share that with us. And Jesus is telling Thomas and the rest of the disciples that if you know me, you know the way to my Father. Well, I would suggest this morning that when Jesus says, I am the way to the Father, the truth about the Father, and the very life of the Father, that he was speaking about the sanctuary service, that I am the way to the Father. I am the truth about who the Father is, and I am the very life of the Father, and that this is what Jesus was referring to. It's very interesting in the book of Acts that Christians are called followers of the way. I don't know if any of you picked up on this. It was in the back of my mind, and I went looking for it this week and discovered it again. Paul went to Damascus. He asked letters from the high priest, Acts 9, verse 2, so that if he found any who were of the way, that he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Acts 19 says that some did not believe, but spoke evil of the way before the multitude. And about that time, there arose a great commotion about the way, referring to the teachings of Christ and how to receive and come to Jesus and to the Father. And then Acts 24, Paul is standing before one of the governors and says, this I confess to you, that according to the way, which the Jewish people, which my people call a sect, so I worship the God of my fathers. So you can see here that the way, and I believe this way, as I mentioned before, refers to the path to the throne of God that Jesus came to share with us. And that path begins with the altar of burnt offering. Today we're going to look at what the meaning of the altar is and a little bit at what the meaning of the laver of washing is. But the things that happen here in the courtyard are confession and a turning away from sin, faith in God's substitutionary sacrifice, and the forgiveness of sins that allows the sinner to go free. And we're also going to be looking in part at the laver of washing. This was a big bowl that was filled with water that was for the priest to wash themselves in before they went into the holy place. But it has a spiritual meaning. This water, the water of life, is the gift of the Holy Spirit. It cleanses us from indwelling sin. It gives us a new heart. Jesus said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water in John 7. But this he spoke of the Spirit, is what the Bible says. And the Holy Spirit comes into the heart and he gives us new desires, new motives. So there is a washing here in the courtyard by blood and water. There is a cleansing by blood and water, and we're going to be studying that a little bit today. So what happened when a sinner came to the sanctuary at the altar of burnt offering? Number one, the sinner came with a knowledge of his own sin. But God had instructed them to bring a perfect, spotless lamb. It could not have one leg longer than the other. It could not have any spot or blemish. It could not have any skin disease, eczema, or anything. It had to be a lamb of the first year in perfect condition. And when the sinner brought that lamb, in symbol, he would place his hands on the head of the animal and confess, verbally confess to God his sins. And in the symbol, his sin was transferred to the head of this lamb. And this lamb that was innocent, that had done nothing wrong, was then the sinner himself took the knife and sacrificed the lamb. And the priest caught some of the blood of that sacrifice, that lamb, and they sprinkled it in the direction of the most holy place 7 times. In some of the offerings, they would actually take the blood and go into the holy place, and right before the most holy place on the veil, they would sprinkle 7 times there the blood on the most holy place. And the most holy place is a symbol of the throne of God. There is a seat there upon which it's called the mercy seat, and above the seat was manifested the glory and presence of God. In other words, this was God's throne room. And the foundation of the throne room, what was inside the Ark of the Covenant? It was the Ten Commandment law. The foundation of God's government was love the Lord your God with all your heart and love your neighbor as yourself. the very foundation of God's government, and then his throne rested upon that. And then his person was seated upon the throne. And so as the priests would sprinkle the blood toward the throne room of God, they were saying, the blood, the sins that have transgressed your law, that have been against your government and against your person, have been paid for by this blood. And the lamb was then taken and consumed on the altar in the fire. But the sinner was forgiven. The sinner was set right with God, and he left with the peace of, he left with two things. He left considering that sin brings death. But he also left considering the greatness of the love of God that would provide a sacrifice for him in order to be saved. And I will, some people, this is a very disturbing ritual. When we zoom out and look at it, that animals were being slain and killed. It's a very disturbing thing. And there's a reason why God chose this. And we're gonna look at this a little bit this morning. Number one, God had us do this because he wanted us to be impressed that sin cost the life of its victim. He wanted there to be no question about that. If we don't confess the sins, then we will die in the same way that the lamb died. We will die for our sins. And God didn't want that, so he provided the animal. But number two, God is not pleased with the death of animals. And some people imagine that maybe he was. I want to share with you this morning from the Bible that God was not pleased with the sacrifice of animals. God made the animals. He made them beautiful. He made them playful. He made some of them strong. God is not pleased that the animals would die, but neither is he pleased that you or I would die. Number three, the Bible tells us, and we'll look at these scriptures together this morning, the blood of lambs can never remove sin. These lambs, these rams, these goats, they were merely a symbol of what God was going to sacrifice in the future for our redemption. Let me share with you a couple scriptures on this. Ezekiel 18:32, and this is in the context of men committing sin. God says, I have no pleasure in the death of the one who dies. In this same chapter, God says, the soul that sins will die. God's warning us. He says, look, if you sin, you'll die, but I have no pleasure in that. That would not bring me pleasure. And he tells the wicked man, turn from your evil ways that you might live. But God provides the sacrifice so that we can live. And then also in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 8, and this is quoting from the Old Testament. This isn't just a New Testament idea. God says this, sacrifice and offering, burnt offering and offerings for sin, you did not desire, nor did you have pleasure in them. In other words, every time a lamb's throat was slit and the blood drained out and horror gripped the person who had to do this, there was horror in heaven for the same thing. God was not pleased that animals should be dying and shedding their blood, but he knew that unless he spoke to us of what he was going to do, we would not be able to understand or appreciate the sacrifice that he was going to make. We needed to understand the sacrifice or it would not have its effect. Another important point that I want us to understand this morning is that man does not bring the sacrifice to God. It is God who provides the sacrifice. Now, in our very human thinking, you know, we go home, we say, oh, this is my house. This is my property there to the trees. Those goats out there, those goats are mine. These are, you know, that's a very human way of thinking. But God has made us stewards of this earth. And everything that he's made, whose is it? It's his. You know, the Bible very clearly tells us that every beast of the forest is mine and the cattle on 1,000 hills are mine. The earth is the Lord's and all its fullness. And so when we bring a lamb, we're not bringing something of our own. Did you make that lamb? We didn't. God made it. And this is vital to understand, that we do not make ourselves right with God by bringing anything to Him. God gives us something and says, this is what you bring to me to make it right. God is the one who provides the sacrifice. Let me prove that to you. You know the story of Abraham and Isaac, Genesis 22. Very powerful story. In that story is encapsulated the sufferings of a divine God and the willing sacrifice of his son. God allowed Abraham to be tested in that way because God was trying to share his heart with Abraham. 2,000 plus years from now, this is what I will go through. Me and my son, this is what we will go through in order to save the human race. But as Abraham was about to offer Isaac his son, as God had commanded, the angel stopped him and directed him behind him, and he saw in the thicket, what did he see? He saw a ram that was caught by its horns in the thorns. And you know, Abraham gave God a new name that day. Do you remember what the name was? He said, the Lord will provide, or the Lord will see to it, literally. In other words, his son was about to die, and all of a sudden there was a ram that was the sacrifice that would save his son. And Abraham in that moment said, who's going to provide the sacrifice that will save my life and the life of my children? Who is it? The Lord will provide. That was the name that Abraham gave him. Also, if you go back in Exodus chapter 12, at the time of the Exodus and the Passover lamb that was slain there, three times in that chapter, God is very clear to tell us, this is not a sacrifice you're making to make peace with me. This is a sacrifice I am making. It says three times in that passage, this is the Lord's Passover, possessive, genitive. This is my Passover, this is my sacrifice. And in verse 26, it says, when your children say to you, what do you mean by this service? What is the significance of the Passover? This is what you are to say to them. It is the Lord's Passover. It is the sacrifice of the Lord who passed over the houses of the children of Israel. This is vital to understand. It's not something that man brings to make himself right with God. It's something that God provides to make man right with him. Let me share with you a scripture on the very blood. In Leviticus chapter 17, verse 11, this is what God says regarding the sacrificial life. For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and who has given it? I have given it to you upon the altar to make atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that makes atonement for your soul or for your life. God was the one who was providing the sacrifice. When a lamb died, it was sacrificing something that God had created and made that he had no pleasure in, the Bible tells us. But if he had not done that, we would not have been able to understand the significance of it. You know, you and I both know that Jesus came to John the Baptist at the River Jordan to be baptized. John pointed to Jesus, and what did he say? Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. I want you to think about it and process this for a moment. There was not a single other people group on the earth, not the Greeks, not the Romans, not the Sabaeans, not anyone in the whole world who could have understood the significance of this statement the way that the Jewish nation could understand it. When John the Baptist pointed at Jesus and called him the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, it had been for 1,500 years that they had been coming to the sanctuary. When they sinned, they understood what sin brings. It brings death. They understood that this lamb was a substitute that God was providing so they could live. All of this was bound up in the ceremony and the symbolism of this. And John says, in Jesus, it's fulfilled. There was not a single other people group on the earth that could have understood this, except the Jewish nation, which is why God had to give them. Because if Jesus had come and lived a righteous life and tried to take back the captives of the enemy by setting them free from disease, setting them free from demon possession, and doing all his wonderful works of mercy, the kingdom of Satan would still have killed Jesus. Jesus would have died, but we wouldn't have understood the significance of it. This is why God had to, in types and symbols, in order to help us understand what he was going to do, he gave us the symbolism of the sanctuary. Our hearts had been in rebellion against God, in rebellion against his law, and our hearts needed to be touched, number one, with the love of God for us, and number two, with awe that he would take the sin and the death that we deserved upon his son. This is why Jesus says this. He says this, if I am lifted up from the earth, and what Jesus is talking about is the cross, if I am lifted up in the full light of what I have come to do, and men and women begin to understand what it is that I've come to do, the result will be that all the peoples of the earth will be drawn to me. But if we don't understand what Jesus has done, if we don't understand, if it's foggy in our minds what he's really done for us, we will not be drawn to Jesus the way that we're supposed to be. And you know what? We have become dull of hearing, as the Bible says. I include myself on that. We've heard the story of Jesus' sacrifice so many times and so frequently, and it's become cliche, and we haven't stopped to really think about the deep meaning of it. And I want to take a look at that this morning. This symbolism was given not because God had any pleasure in the death of bulls or rams or goats, but because it pointed to a greater reality. It pointed to the Lamb of God who would give his life for the sins of the whole world. Open your Bibles with me to Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9, we're going to take a look at verse 8. Hebrews 9, verse 8. Now, Paul is talking about the sanctuary. You'll pick up on that. Verse 8 says this, "The Holy Spirit indicates this, that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest while the first tabernacle was still standing. It was symbolic for the present time, in which both gifts and sacrifices were offered." In other words, he's talking about this. He's saying the Holy Spirit has indicated that this was happening all the while this was happening, and the services and gifts and the sacrifices of the sanctuary, that all of these things were just symbols. But notice what he says, verse 11, "But Christ came as high priest of the good things to come, with the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is, not of this creation." In other words, there is a tabernacle in heaven that is not part of this creation here on earth. In verse 12, he says this, "And not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood, he entered the most holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption." This is the symbol, but Christ is the reality. Turn with me in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 4. Notice what Hebrews 10, verse 4 says. And we've looked at this verse already. It says, "For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sin. Therefore, when he came into the world," this is speaking of Jesus, "he said," Jesus, these are the words Jesus said just before his incarnation, "Sacrifice and offering, God, you did not desire, but a body you have prepared for me." In other words, the symbols of the rams and the goats and the sheep, those are not the true sacrifices you have ordained. It is the body that you have prepared for me that will be sacrificed. Verse 6, "In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, you had no pleasure." Verse 7, "Then I said, behold, I have come. In the volume of the book it is written of me to do your will, O God. You know, we know this. The most often quoted and most recognized scripture in the Bible, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that what? He gave. Do you understand that? Do you hear that? This is not, none of it has ever been a sacrifice that we bring to make ourselves right with God. Who gave the sacrifice so that we could have life? God gave it. And God did something else amazing. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:21, He made Him, that is Jesus. God made Jesus, who knew no sin, who never sinned, to be sin for us, so that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ, in Him. And you start to think about this, it's a challenging thought. I want to look a little bit at the story of Gethsemane this morning. This is how they used to extract the oil from the olive. This stone, this heavy stone, was placed in, the olives were placed there on the stone, and then this great weight of this heavy stone was rolled and crushed all the olives and brought out the oil. And Gethsemane means the place of the olive press. That's where Jesus went the night that he was overcome with darkness and our sin was placed upon him. It's interesting, God gave this command in the Old Testament when speaking about the seven-branch candlestick. He says, you shall command the children of Israel that they bring the pure oil of pressed olives for the light to cause the lamp to burn continually. Can a lamp burn without fuel? Can't. Can it give light without fuel? It doesn't. And the light that was given was the burning of this oil. In Jesus' day, what were the lamps made of? They were made of clay, right? This was pottery, this clay pottery. And in it, we studied this last week, in it was placed this oil, and then when the wick was placed in there to draw the oil out, it burned and gave its light. I want us to think a little bit about this. Also, these lamps, in a certain sense, are symbols of you and me as well. You know, Paul says in 2 Corinthians 4, he says, we have this treasure in earthen vessels. The treasure that Paul is talking about is the Holy Spirit. And the earthen vessel that he's talking about is you and me. It's the light of the glory of the power of God, or the glory of God, that is shining in the face of Jesus. We have that in earthen vessels through the gift of the Holy Spirit. Let me ask you this. There's a parallel here to the creation of man. What was man made from in the beginning? From the dust of the earth, from the clay. And what filled him and gave him life? What did God breathe into the nostrils of Adam, the first man? The breath of life. That word in the Hebrew, breath, is also translated in many other places as spirit. So again, we have a clay receptacle in which the Holy Spirit is, and it gives life, and it gives light. Do you know, understand what happened at the fall? What was inside of Adam after God breathed into him the spirit of life? The Holy Spirit. In Adam was the Holy Spirit. And he became a living soul because the spirit of life was in him. And, you know, Psalms chapter 104 says that God clothes himself with light, but it also says that he clothes others with light. And Adam had a robe of light at his creation. And that was an outward symbol of an inward reality. The Holy Spirit was in the heart, was in man, and the robe of light was outside of him, but it was only the external marker of the inward reality. But what happened when man sinned? When man transgressed the command of God, the Spirit of God in him departed. The Shekinah glory that had been his covering departed, and he was left naked. And in the place where God had written his law, love to God and love to your man, was replaced by the spirit of selfishness. Pride and hatred, envy, accusation, bitterness, malice, wrath, lust, and every other thing replaced the dwelling place of God and where God's law should have been. When we sinned, we disconnected ourselves from the divine presence. And it could be well said of us that we became the habitation of demons, a prison of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hated bird. But God did not sit around and allow this horror to come upon us without doing something. He intervened. He intervened between us. Notice what John chapter 8, verse 12 says. Jesus spoke to them again, saying, "I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have," what? "The light of life." I'm going to suggest to you that this light is a metaphor for the Holy Spirit, and that Jesus was born with the Holy Spirit and walked, he was anointed with the Holy Spirit through his whole ministry, and that Holy Spirit gave him life and it gave life to others. Let me share with you a couple other scriptures that bring this to light. John 1 verse 4. You know, John 1 verse 1 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Down in verse 4 it says, "In him was life." In Jesus was life, and the life was the light of men. You see again how life and light are connected here in this passage? Were any of us born with the gift of the Holy Spirit and being connected with God? We've been born disenfranchised, disinherited from that connection with God. Jesus came to bring that light back to us. Notice what Jesus says in John 6:63. It is the Spirit who gives what? Life. The flesh profits nothing. We were all born according to the flesh, and flesh cannot inherit the kingdom of God, but we need to be born again according to the Spirit. This is why Psalms 27 says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life." You see there how light and life are connected again? And then Romans 8:11 tells us this: "If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you." Turn with me in your Bibles to Mark chapter 14. Mark chapter 14, we're going to look at what happened in Gethsemane. Mark chapter 14, verses 32 through 36. You know, all through Jesus' life, he was able to say, "The Father has not left me, the Father is with me because I always do the things that please him." The Holy Spirit at his baptism rested upon Jesus, never departed from Jesus. But notice this, before we read in Mark, this is the same story in Luke, just before the Gethsemane experience. This is what Jesus says: "I say to you that this which is written must still be accomplished in me." In other words, this scripture is going to be fulfilled in the future, shortly. "And he was numbered with the transgressors." I have read this scripture before, and I've assumed that it means that Jesus was crucified in the middle of two thieves and that he was numbered with those who had transgressed. But I don't believe that that's what this is talking about anymore. I believe what this is saying, and we'll get at it from the story here. I believe what this is saying is that Jesus was treated as a sinner, and the light and the glory of God departed from him, and he was left in the same condition that you and I were in. Let's look at this. Mark chapter 14, verse 32. Then they came to the place which was named the Olive Press, or Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." Verse 33, and he took Peter, James, and John with him, and he began to be troubled and deeply distressed. Then he said to them, "My soul," or my life, "is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death. Stay here and watch." And he went a little farther and fell on the ground, and he prayed that if it were possible, that the hour might pass from him. The hour that Jesus was praying would pass from him is the hour of darkness, we find later. This is Jesus' hour of darkness. You know, before in his ministry, he could say, "I am the light of the world. The Father is with me. If anyone follows me, he will have the light of life," because Jesus had the light of life. But this hour is the hour of darkness for Jesus. Verse 36, he said, "Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will." It's interesting if you read the account in Desire of Ages. Ellen White will quote Psalm 22, verse 1. That's the verse that says, my God, why have you forsaken me?" We know Jesus said that on the cross from the Gospels. But she says these words were also said in Gethsemane, because in Gethsemane, God was withdrawing his light and his life from his son to the point where Jesus said, "My life is exceedingly sorrowful, my soul, even to the point of death." And this is Isaiah 53, verse 12, speaking of the same event. Says, "I will divide him a portion with the great. He shall divide the spoil with the strong." Why? Because he poured out his, it says soul, but it could also be rightly translated life. He poured out his life unto death. Let me try and explain what is happening here, what I'm seeing here. We were under a death sentence because of our sin, and we disconnected ourselves from God. Jesus came, and he was going to take that sentence upon himself. And just as the sinner put his hands on the head of the lamb, Isaiah 53 tells us that God has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. Jesus in the garden began to feel the same thing that Adam and Eve felt, except a billion times multiplied. How did they feel when they took from the tree and recognized the Spirit, the divine Spirit of God had departed from them? They felt naked. They recognized that they were naked. They felt a chill and a horror come over them, that they had disconnected themselves from the life and from their Savior. And when God was putting all the sins upon Jesus, Jesus began to feel the exact same thing. His very life was being poured out in the garden. Why was that? Because the sin that you and I had committed needed to be dealt with, and it was falling upon Jesus. But there's another reason also why this was happening. Had Jesus done anything to be worthy of having of death? Had he done anything? Had he ever transgressed? He had not. In other words, Jesus had never done anything to separate himself from the life of God. The Holy Spirit was still in him, constantly there. And it was giving him life, and it was giving others life. But Jesus in the garden was now willingly pouring that life out, because sin was not taking it away from him. He was willingly pouring that life out. And he was pouring that life out into my life, into your life, so that we could have life. Listen to how Ellen White describes this time in the garden. Throughout his life on earth, he had walked in the light of God's presence. When in conflict with men who were inspired by the very spirit of Satan, he could say, "He that sent me is with me. The Father hath not left me alone, for I always do the things that please him." What was it that departed from Adam and Eve when they disobeyed? It was the presence of God. Jesus could say, "That's never happened to me." But now he seemed to be shut out from the light of God's sustaining presence. Now he was numbered with the transgressors. The guilt of fallen humanity he must bear. He, upon him who knew no sin, must be laid the iniquity of us all. So dreadful does sin appear to him, so great is the weight of guilt which he must bear, that he is tempted to fear it will shut him out forever from the Father's love. Feeling how terrible is the wrath of God against transgression, he exclaims, "My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death." With the issues of the conflict before him, Christ's soul was filled with dread of separation from God. Satan told them that if he became the surety and substitute for a sinful world, that separation would be eternal, that he would be identified with Satan's kingdom and would nevermore be one with God. And what was to be gained by this sacrifice? How hopeless appeared the guilt and ingratitude of men. In its hardest feature, Satan pressed the situation upon the Redeemer. The people who claim to be above all others in temporal and spiritual advantages have rejected you. The Jewish nation doesn't even want anything to do with you. They are seeking to destroy you. The very foundation, the very center and seal of all the promises made to them as a peculiar people. One of your own disciples who's listened to your own instruction has been among the foremost in church activities will betray you, Judas. And one of your most zealous followers will deny you, Peter. All will forsake you. Christ's whole being abhorred the thought that those whom he had undertaken to save, those whom he loved so much, should unite in the plots of Satan. This pierced his soul. You think about that. Our Savior was about ready to lay down his life to save us. And what pierced his soul the most was that we didn't understand what he was doing, and in fact, we were actually in league with his enemy. This broke the heart of Jesus. He's about to give a sacrifice, and no one seems to care. This is what Satan was trying to tell him. The conflict was terrible. Its measure was the guilt of his nation, of his accusers and betrayer, the guilt of a whole world lying in wickedness. The sins of men weighed heavily upon Christ, and the sense of God's wrath against sin was what? Crushing out his life. In order for there to be light in the lamp, the oil had to be crushed so that its oil could, the olive had to be crushed so its oil could come out. And only that could give light and life to the lamp. What's happening in the garden with Jesus, his very life is being crushed out of him by your sin and mine. He's willingly pouring that life out so that we could have life. Three times he uttered the prayer, "Father, let this cup pass from me." Three times his humanity shrank from the last crowning sacrifice. But do you know what it was that caused Jesus to go through with it in the end? She tells us in the next sentence. This is what she says. "But now the history of the human race comes up before the world's Redeemer. He sees that the transgressors of the law, if left to themselves, must perish. He sees the helplessness of man. He sees the power of sin. The woe, the lamentations of a doomed world rise before him, and he beholds its impending fate, and his decision is made. He will save man at any cost to himself." You know, Jesus in the garden began to feel the way that sinners do when we commit sin against God, except that we're numb to it. We have not known the love and the connection with God the way Jesus did. Jesus was in the bosom of the Father. He'd never not known the love of God. He had never been outside of the presence of God. The Holy Spirit had always been with him, and now it was being taken away from him. It caused his whole being to shudder before the face of death and darkness. And Jesus saw that wave of horror, that wave of sin, that wave of death coming, and it was crushing out his soul. And he was like, Father, if there's any way that we can do this without that happening to me, let's do that. But what caused him to turn and decide to go through with it was looking over here and realizing, if I step out of the way of what's coming, it's going to hit all of them. It will crush them. It will destroy them. And so Jesus said, I will stay here. I will bear the crushing weight and the horror and the separation from my Father so that they will never have to. That's what happened in Gethsemane. The wrath of God against sin was crushing out his life. And Jesus was pouring out that life so that we could receive it. Nestor, there's some slides there. Advance to the... Keep going. There we go.
Sing to
Lord of our sinful hearts, 'cause he is our great redeemer. And sing to Jesus, 'cause his is the throne, now and forever. He is the King of heaven. Sing to Jesus, 'cause we are his own, now and forever. Sing for the love our God has shown. When we forsook the life of God through transgression, Jesus took our sins and he poured the very life, the divinity that was in him, in order to save our lives. He gave us of his own spirit. He poured out his life unto death. He poured out that divine life to give us life. And so that death would be vanquished forever. And he brought life and immortality to light. Dear Heavenly Father, we dimly understand these things. We don't fully understand what the sacrifice was that Jesus made on the cross. Or by that matter, Lord, the sacrifice that you made in watching your son cry out, "Father, Father, why have you forsaken me?" You love your son. You had never been separated from him. And yet in that hour, you had to stand back and watch sin destroy and crush the life of your son. Father, we don't begin to understand these things. Move on our hearts. Give us understanding. Give us spiritual eyesight, Father, that we may see your love. Draw us to yourself, Father. We are the objects of your love, unspeakable love, unspeakable love. And pour the life of Jesus into us, Father. Give us of his spirit. Lord, we are dead in trespasses and sins. Give us your life. Give us righteousness. Give us peace with you. Give us the light of life that Jesus came to give us. And help us understand your love, Father. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.